the main way we can figure this out is by looking at certain historical and philosophical precedents. On the one side, he seems to be channeling Jean-Jacques Rousseau and the idea of the collective will, which of course is what then leads to the excesses of the Reign of Terror in the French Revolution with Robespierre and Saint-Just and these people. That's totalitarian liberalism. Totalitarian liberalism also has a history in Britain. Keynes is a pretty good example of it. But here in the United States, I think we can say that the home of totalitarian liberalism, or you might say something shading over into the corporate state, is the Wall Street wing of the Democratic Party. And let me try to point out what I mean by this. We have some Democratic presidents, above all Franklin D. Roosevelt, and that's four elections, and Kennedy is one election. This is the anti-Wall Street wing, with whatever flaws and contradictions they might have had. The Wall Street wing, I would say, is Woodrow Wilson, Harry Truman, Jimmy Carter, and now Obama. And we have to realize that there are fundamentally two kinds of Democrats, right? The anti-Wall Street type is pro-labor, has populist overtones, and generally is about the best we're going to find in this system. But the Wall Street wing of the Democratic Party is really a tragedy. I'd like to talk about Wilson most, but the track record of these people is, if you look at Wilson, you'll see that we had the biggest civil liberties emergency ever, worse than John Adams and the Sedition Acts back in the early 19th century. That was under Woodrow Wilson. We should also remember, under Harry S. Truman, this was somebody who essentially did his best to attack and destroy the New Deal coalition, right? He was, you know, doing things like, you know, open police state attacks on labor unions, right? Strike breaking, unbelievable stuff. And this, of course, then led to a period of Democratic Party defeats. Carter is the same thing in terms of economics. And now Obama. I think in terms of agitation and propaganda today, right, given how little people know about history, it's useful to say Obama equals the worst of Lyndon B. Johnson, the worst of Carter, and the worst of Nixon. He is the military defeat, catastrophic war side of LBJ. And it's a tragedy, too, because LBJ had real credentials as a reformer and as a progressive force in U.S. society. Look at things like the Civil Rights Act, look at Medicare, look at any number of things. But this, of course, was all destroyed then by Vietnam, and that's the challenge to people who want to support Obama today, is you've got to realize that war policy will guarantee the defeat and the virtual extinction of progressive causes for many generations. Remember, it was Carter as an economic disaster that got Teddy Kennedy out, and Johnson as a war disaster that got Robert Kennedy to come forward and try to oust them and deny them the Democratic Party nomination, which I think in both cases there was a fighting chance for this. But if we say Obama is the worst of LBJ and the lost war, the worst of Carter in economic chaos, and the worst of Nixon in terms of these police state excesses, because we have renditions going on, we have black sites, we have kidnappings, we have preventive detention. He can throw anybody in jail that he wants to. We have continuous wiretapping immunity for wiretapping telephone companies and all the rest of this. I think that's a good formula for what people may remember today. But I would like to propose that the real connection is Woodrow Wilson.
Now, could you, Webster, remind us when Woodrow Wilson was in power?
Yeah, this is basically, it's from the elections of 1912. He wins in 1912, and then he wins in 1916. And this is the person who brought the U.S. into World War One, which was a great historical catastrophe. And essentially, instead of solving the issue posed by World War One, he made it much worse by allowing the Allies to defeat Germany, to crush Germany, and then impose this Carthaginian peace settlement at Versailles with reparations and all the rest of it, which, of course, was the food off which demagogues like Hitler then fed. He compounded and made worse this tremendous tragedy. Let me just reel off a couple of things about Wilson and also compare him to Obama. Wilson is the most academic of all presidents, right? People talk about how Obama's an academic, he's cerebral. Well, Wilson is the only person holding a PhD who ever became president. And we get into this area of the pedant in the White House, right? The academic, aloof, analytical, detached from people's feelings. Woodrow Wilson is the only president, he's a president who got the Nobel Peace Prize. Actually, Theodore Roosevelt had gotten it, but Woodrow Wilson got the Nobel Peace Prize in 1919, ironically, as he was basically championing the Versailles peace settlement, which was the guarantee, as Keynes and others wrote at the time, that there was going to be another war in 25 years. So there you have it, or 20 years, even less. Woodrow Wilson ran in 1916 as a peace candidate. He was going to be the guy who would keep you out of war. Remember that the war in Europe had begun in July, August 1914. So there was more than 2 years between that and the U.S. presidential election. And the big question was, most people didn't want any part of this. They wanted to stay out of it. It was a conflict of imperialisms, none of which was very palatable. And especially if you were German or if you were Irish or if you were any number of other nationalities that were not so in love with the British as Woodrow Wilson was, you'd want to stay out of it. So imagine Woodrow Wilson running in 1916 as an outspoken peace candidate, much more so than Obama, right? Much, much more, I'll keep you out of war. And then revealing himself as a total duplicitous hypocrite, turning around then, and in April of 1917, just about a month after taking office for the second term, demanding a declaration of war against Germany. And this is where things begin to get really wild, because Woodrow Wilson then says, we cannot tolerate dissent. We will not allow people to speak out against the war. And this then becomes the Espionage Act and the Sedition Act of 1917 and 1918. And this essentially says that espionage is no longer a matter of taking state secrets or secret information and transmitting this to some foreign enemy. But espionage is simply the stating in public of opinions that might be of some use to the foreign enemy. In other words, just an opinion saying this war is wrong or we should make peace. That became a crime. And this hurt quite a number of people. Eugene V. Debs, of course, is the famous one that Woodrow Wilson put in jail, right? The Socialist Party candidate for president, who had gotten significant votes. But how about something like the poet E.E. Cummings was an ambulance driver in northern France, and he said to a friend, you know, I really don't hate Germany. He was put in a concentration camp on the basis of that. If you spoke German in public or even in private, this could have been a crime. The U.S. beer industry has never recovered from the horrors of this. Probably the most effective thing they had going was personal ostracism. For example, the distinguished violinist Fritz Kreisler was publicly humiliated and mortified because he was German. The most extreme, though, is they decided that nothing that would criticize the government, right, any criticism of Wilson, you could say, Wilson is no good. That was a crime. And you couldn't send that through the mail. The most effective suppression was newspapers, of course, and other written stuff had to go through the mail. So with the help of Wilson's postmaster general, they said 75 newspapers are banned from the U.S. mail. And this included the left liberal organ, The Nation, which is still around today. Imagine a world where The Nation cannot circulate because it's expressed something saying, well, this war is not good because we're losing a lot on the social front, and so forth. So I think you get the idea of a horrendous crackdown under these two laws, the Espionage Act and the Sedition Act. And I think parts of this is still on the books. And, of course, Obama doesn't care anyway because he has arrogated to himself the ability to put people in jail and to keep them there. The Federal Reserve goes through under Woodrow Wilson, right? Similar to Obama's total subordination to Wall Street interests, as indicated by Geithner and Summers and Volcker, and the fact that he's getting all the money from Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan Chase and so forth. So this gets you the idea of Woodrow Wilson as a detached, academic, pedantic, cold hypocrite. And I think we see something like this. So I think, though, the lesson concerning this war situation is that when you're dealing with a Wall Street Democrat, which is what we've got, and I think more and more people are seeing it, the temptation for totalitarian police state repression is very strong, and you can see this. It's a part of the intellectual life of the early 20th century that people have lost touch with. Take, for example, a novelist like John Dos Passos. He was considered by some to be the greatest American writer, at least during certain phases of critical evolution. And his trilogy, this USA, right? It's a 3-volume set. Essentially targets Theodore Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson as the twin demons that had set the U.S. on the wrong course, right? With imperialism, certainly they both agreed on that. They're both progressives. They both present themselves as reformers. But somehow, out of all the reforms, Wall Street gets stronger and stronger, and the will of Morgan, meaning just Wall Street in general, I guess, today, Goldman Sachs, J.P. Morgan, well, they're still there. Morgan Stanley, they're still there, too. They've survived. That this will of Wall Street gets to be stronger and stronger. So I think people in the anti-war movement, well, remember, under Woodrow Wilson, 2,000 people were arrested. Imagine that. 2,000 anti-war activists were arrested and prosecuted, not all convicted, maybe not too many convicted, but arrested and prosecuted is probably bad enough. And that's what you had under this very aloof, Anglophile president, Woodrow Wilson. And I think it's hard to agitate with this today because nobody knows much about Woodrow Wilson anymore. But if you wanted to pick one that Obama recapitulates, I'm afraid it's Woodrow Wilson. And that means a historical tragedy on a tremendous scale to the excesses of the reign of terror in the French Revolution with Robespierre and Saint-Just and these people. That's totalitarian liberalism. Totalitarian liberalism also has a history in Britain. Keynes is a pretty good example of it. But the main way we can figure this out is by looking at certain historical and philosophical precedents. On the one side, he seems to be channeling Jean-Jacques Rousseau and the idea of the collective will, which, of course, is what then leads. We have some Democratic presidents, above all Franklin D. Roosevelt, and that's 4 elections, and Kennedy is 1 election. This is the anti-Wall Street wing, with whatever flaws and contradictions they might have had. The Wall Street wing, I would say, is Woodrow Wilson, Harry Truman, Jimmy Carter, and now Obama. And we have to realize that there are fundamentally 2 kinds of Democrats, right? The anti-Wall Street type is pro-labor, has populist overtones, and generally is about the best. Here in the United States, I think we can say that the home of totalitarian liberalism, or you might say something shading over into the corporate state, is the Wall Street wing of the Democratic Party. Now, let me try to point out what I mean by this.